Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to today's session of the course Contemporary Political Analysis. In the previous session, we tried to understand what political analysis is all about, and of course, the relevance of political analysis to us as students and as scholars of political science. We tried to look at the various levels of analysis, the micro, the macro, the medium, and of course, the macro level of political analysis, and every other issue. But today, you are going to discuss the science of political science. Why is this topic very important? It is important because contemporary political analysis itself is a field in political science. And so to have analysis that is empirical, one must understand the scientivism of political science. Because a political analyst must ensure that his analysis is empirical, his analysis is based on pragmatism and factualism. We must ensure that your analysis is devoid of every interference or value. And so you must ensure that your analysis is scientific, and that, of course, is why political science is a scientific field of study. And so to be able to carry out an analysis that is empirical, that is scientific, that is pragmatic, that is factual, one must understand the integrity of science. A political scientist must ensure that he gives a scientific analysis to issues and to phenomena that he or she, of course, is called, you know, to analyze. Okay, so today we're going to look at the science of political science. It is important to state here that there have been a lot of argument and a lot of opinion regarding the scientivism of political science, whether or not political science is a scientific field of study, or should political science be regarded as science or not. And so the basic issue that we are to discuss today is to, you know, is to give credence to the fact that political science is a scientific field of study, and of course to also prove and to justify the argument that political science is a scientific field of study. But first of all, what is science? If one is carrying out an argument whether or not a field of study is scientific, then it is germane that we understand the concept of science. It is only when you understand science and what makes up science that one will be able to do an in-depth analysis and to further argue that political science is a scientific field of study. Science is a systematic and an organized way of inquiry. What makes science science is the fact that it is systematic. It is organized. It is procedural. It is based on fact and evidence. It is based on factualism and, of course, pragmatism. And so when we talk about science, we are looking at that field of study, that area that is organized, that uses systematic and procedural approach in arriving at conclusions and, you know, and generalization. And so if science is a systematic and an organized way of inquiry, one can also argue that political science is scientific because analysis in political science, investigation and experiment in political science is scientifically conducted. In other words, it is done systematically. What makes science science, as far from the fact that it is systematic, is that science has scientific methodologies that are employed, that are adopted in every scientific investigation. And so the argument is that if science is science because science adopts certain systematic approach, certain methodologies, certain steps and procedures carried out in scientific investigation, and it means that political science is also a scientific field of study because political science adopts scientific methodologies. There are scientific methodologies adopted in every scientific investigations. These scientific methodologies are also employed in political science, and that, of course, qualifies political science as a scientific field of study. Even though, at this juncture, it's important to note that there's a difference between pure science and social sciences. Political science is not a pure science like physics, like biology, like chemistry. No, political science falls within the category of social science. Social science or social sciences are fields of study that studies human behavior in relation to human behavior. Our fields of study like political science, sociology, economics all fall within this category of social sciences. Having said that, what are those scientific methodologies that are employed in political science? This topic is very important to every student of political science. Because if you say you are a political scientist, then you must give evidence to prove that, yes, you are a scientist. And of course, a political scientist at that. In every scientific investigation, we have what we call scientific methodologies. Methodologies are steps that are taken in every scientific investigation. And those methodologies are what we have on the board. The first of the methodology is observation. Observation is a very important method in every scientific investigation. How do you begin an experiment without an observation? Most experiments conducted are products of what man or what the scientist has observed within his environment. And so the first step in every scientific investigation is the observation of data. How do you tell that your child is sick, for instance, before you take the child to the hospital? You observe. And so observation is very important. Observation has to do with careful examination of an object or the careful examination of a particular phenomenon or a particular situation within the society. And of course, it could even be within the international system, depending on what your investigation is about. Observation is very important. There are two types of observation. We have what we call participant observation and non-participant observation. The participant observation is that type of observation whereby the observer puts himself within the phenomenon that he's examining. He becomes a participant, he becomes an actor in the entire process just to get first-hand information about the phenomenon that he or she intends, to carry out research on. I give you an instance. If I want to carry out a research on why we have increasing rate of student dropout in universities, I could assume that I'm a student, attend classes, go to the hostel, participate in activities that students are participating. Go to classes and try to see the behavior of students in relation to lectures, behavior of students in relation to, to studies and all of that. And so in that case, you would say I am involved in what we call participant observation. Non-participant observation is that which the researcher does not necessarily need to be there or be involved in the whole process, of trying to examine the situation or the variables which is writing on. I give you an instance also, somebody may want to do a research on Boko Haram, and you go to Maiduguri or to Adamawa or to Yobe State because you want to see firsthand the plight of the people who are victims of Boko Haram. When you do that, it means you are involved in what we call participant observation. The non-participant observation, on the other hand, is that which the researcher does not need to situate himself within the context and environment within which his research is to be carried upon. That is a non-participant observation. The next stage in every scientific investigation is what we call statement of problem. In science, when we say problem, it doesn't mean wahala, like we know in Nigeria, or palaver. No, that's not the kind of problem we're talking about. Problem in every scientific investigation has to do with the phenomenon that a researcher has identified, the factor that instigates the researcher to want to carry out his research on a particular topic or on a particular area. I give you an instance. My PhD research is on Islamophobia in Nigeria. And so the first thing you do in your defense is that they want to ask you, of all topics in Nigeria or in the world, why did you choose Islamophobia, for instance? And so I now begin to think about issues that we call statement of problem, the factors that I've seen from my observation that has spurred me, that has instigated in me the interest to write on that issue. You cannot carry out a scientific investigation without a reason. That reason, that factor that propels you to want to do a research in a particular area is what we call statement of problem. Okay, the next is collection of data. When you observe, when you have your statement of problem, you now begin to gather data. That's what we call collection or data gathering. You gather your data. Data are information. They are facts that you need, to back up your arguments and, of course, to carry out a scientific investigation on a particular subject area. So you collect data. When you collect data, the next thing you do is to classify this data. What we call in political science taxonomy, taxonomization of data. You classify. And in classifying data, we have certain indices that we use for classification. You can classify based on sex, you can classify based on race, you can classify based on height, you can classify based on gender, you can classify based on educational background, and so on and so forth, depending on the kind of research that you are carrying out. I give you an instance. If one is carrying out a research on, say, the rate of HIV in Nigeria, you must classify your data to tell us, do we have majority of the victims of HIV as men or as women? When you do that, it means you are classifying based on gender. Okay? One is trying to do a research on academic performance in Nigerian universities. You are going to classify data. Are you looking at it in the angle of private universities and public universities, or you're just looking at it within a particular system? There are different, you know, indices that you can use to classify. If you are doing a research, for instance, on racial discrimination in Europe, the basics for your classification of data will be race, because you are talking about different races being discriminated upon, or a particular race being discriminated by another race. When you classify data, classification is very germane because it makes the research easy. It gives you, you know, a direction on what to do, what you need, and all of that. And that is why it's very important to classify data. Sometimes, when you look at projects of students, you will see that they have a column for data, you know, data analysis. And in that column, you will see biography of respondents. You will see sex, you will see occupation, you will see age, and all of that. Those are examples of what we call data classification. That brings us to the next stage in every scientific investigation, which we call hypothesis. Hypotheses are conjectural statements. Hypotheses are statements that one cannot conclude that they are neither true nor false until they are subjected to, you know, to experiment, which will not be, you know, a way of verifying the authenticity of such hypotheses. Hypotheses are conjectural statements. And basically, we have two types of hypotheses. We have what we call the null hypothesis and the alternate hypothesis. The null hypothesis is that hypothesis that you don't need to subject it to a test to conclude that it is false. I give you an instance. You have 400 students in my class, and I say all the 400 level students in this, all the 400 level, 400 students in this class will graduate at the same time. It's not possible. That is a null hypothesis, because you know that it's practically impossible to have 400 students in a class and they all graduate at the same time. It's not possible. Somebody must wait behind. Okay, when I say, for instance, that Buhari was going to win this election, it was an alternate hypothesis because you cannot conclude that he will win or he won't win. We needed to subject that hypothesis to a test. And of course, the last election was the experiment to prove whether or not he was going to win. But of course, he won, and that means the hypothesis has been verified. And that takes us to the next stage, what we call experimentation. Experimentation is the process of subjecting hypothesis to test to verify its authenticity. So every hypothesis needs to be subject, you know, to experiment, to verify. And that's why most times when you go to the hospital and the doctor observes the patient, the doctor does not conclude that the patient has malaria or typhoid. But regardless of how the doctor feels, regardless of how the symptom looks like the symptom of malaria or the symptom of typhoid, the doctor will still insist that a test should be carried out. That is also a scientific methodology, testing the validity of a particular hypothesis. When a hypothesis is subjected to test and is found to be valid, that hypothesis becomes a theory. It's no longer hypothesis. In other words, a theory is a hypothesis that has been tested and found to be valid. For instance, before now, people talk about the law of gravity. Scientists try to explain why if you throw a particular object up, that the object will not be suspended in the sky, it will drop down because of the force of gravity pushing it down. But can you see the force? Can you feel it? The answer is no. But you can test that and see the object will definitely drop. And that's to tell you that when you subject hypotheses to experimentation and they are found to be valid, they become theories. Theories are scientific tools. Tools that are generally accepted universally as basis, you know, for political analysis. Theories are like lens. It gives clearer vision. It gives clearer understanding of a particular phenomenon. Theories are tools that enables you to understand, to explain, and to predict. And like I said in one of my sessions, a political scientist that does not have sufficient knowledge of theory is as good as a market woman, or better still, a carpenter. What makes you a political scientist, what distinguishes you as a political scientist, is how much theory you know. When theories are subjected over time and they are still found to be valid, they become laws. And these laws are universally acceptable. And so, ladies and gentlemen, what we have been able to do so far is to try to understand why political science is a scientific field of study. I would say it is a scientific field of study because, like every scientific investigation, scientific methodologies are employed. And in political science, we apply these scientific methodologies. And that makes political science a scientific field of study. And so in the next session, we are going to try to look at the limitations, the factors that limits political science from having high degree of precision, predictability, and all of that. And so I see you in the next class. Thank you.